Dirt Poor Islanders, written by Winnie Dunn, read by Ana Ika. An unabridged Hachette Australia audio edition, produced by Hachette Australia, an imprint of Hachette Australia Propriety Limited. Text copyright Winnie Dunn, 2024. Recording copyright Hachette Australia Propriety Limited, 2024. Recorded at Square Sound Studios, Sydney, Australia. All rights reserved. Soil. Blood-soaked soil as flesh of flesh became full form. A grounded woman, named Va'e Popua, was crying under a toa tree. Away! Away! From above, the god of gods watched as his son was emerging, crown first. Fluids flowed from the depths of Va'e Popua. Her son was born into earth, covered in kaka and tissue. When her son took his first breaths, Va'e Popua carried him to the edge of a nearby lagoon, a stretch of water that expanded horizon to horizon. Within gentle ripples, she cleaned her son's soft scalp, which was the color of bark. He wailed and wailed as the grounded woman's thighs, thick as dirt, trembled in the wash. Va'e Popua gnashed at her son's umbilical cord with her teeth and swore silence of her infidelity with divinity. Placing a kiss on her newborn's wide forehead with soil-soaked lips, she murmured, "We make of each other only." Alone, Va'e Popua raised her son, taught him the ways of Fonua, the earth. Talo, Ufi, and Manioke were to always be planted in sets of three. Brown coconut was for milking, whereas green coconut was for juicing. All seafood was permitted for consumption except for turtle. Its shell was the sacred mound on which they sailed through the endless moana. As the toa tree grew ever taller, so too did the boy. From sand to sprout to leaves to fruit, it became clear to him that everything emerged from somewhere. So, when his arms became as lanky as brambles, the demigod questioned his mother, "What are we made from?" Va'e Popua sifted through shells with her starfish-wide palms and replied, "Land." The lagoon stretched further still, and so too did the demigod. From coral to seaweed, to salt to wave, it became clearer to him that everything emerged in pairs. Somehow, he knew that he could not be made of woman alone. So, when the demigod's calves became as wide as stumps, he questioned his grounded mother yet again. "I am made from what?" Slowly planting taro with her stiff knuckles and gnashing inside her cheeks, Va'e Popua whispered, "Different." When the earth and demigod could no longer expand and there was nothing more to know below, Va'e Popua pointed skywards. From bark to flesh to cloud to heaven, she could no longer hide her shame from her son. In a hollow tone, she confessed, "Majesty." The grounded woman watched through salt water as her son ascended, crown first, upon the branches of the toa tree. The demigod climbed into Pulotu, the spiritual realm, where the god of gods was awaiting the return of his seed. 1. "Speak English, you savage!" That's what the Palangi said as soon as they heard my grandmother's voice. Especially Sharon, the bogan who lived across from us. An inflatable pool sat idly on her front lawn and shone stark white in the suburban sun. Like a wax-coated skeleton, Shaza stood dripping next to her wheelie bins. The streets of Mount Druitt hummed with heat, yet I was shivering behind my grandmother. Nana yelled back in Tongan, "Palangi fia mea!" This roughly translated to, "All white people think they are better than us." Shaza stared us down like we were a segment on 60 Minutes and stomped her thongs on the concrete driveway as if she understood what my grandmother was saying. The slap of Shaz's rubber soles echoed throughout the western suburbs before she shrieked at us,
"Pack your hula hula crap and shove it! It can't be out on public property like that, you loon!"
Shaz's saggy, pale skin was sunburnt in the spots her Australian flag bikini didn't cover. The hula hula crap was our ngatu, a type of Tongan mat. My grandmother's ngatu was spread out underneath us and all across our front yard until it spilled onto the footpath in front of our house. Nana and I had spent all morning painting patterns on the flattened mulberry bark as she taught me every shape. Fo'uhea, to mark the plantings of taro, manioke and ufi. Manulua, to symbolise the winged meeting of two birds. Vakatou, to illustrate the double-hulled canoe that allowed us to be the first seafaring people of the world. Whakamalu okatea, which was Nana's favourite design because it revealed the story of a woman who gave birth under a toa tree. Even though my grandmother never said it to me, I reckoned Whakamalu okatea was her favourite because Nana was also born under the shade of fronds, which had spread over the ground of our village, Malapo. As the sun wore into evening, I looked up at Nana from the ngatu. This close, I saw that the marks on my grandmother's face were like the shapes on the ngatu. A blotch under her left eye, like a rock, was my father. A cluster of beauty spots on the bridge of her nose were my aunties, Meadow, Jasmine, Heilala, Lily, and Daisy. In wrinkles by my grandmother's mouth was my uncle Talasi and Nana's husband, Tupou. And somewhere in the folds of her paws were my brother Jared, my sister Nettie, and me. Crows croaked above us on power lines and the shadows of palm trees grew over us. My fingers curled around the thin handle of a paintbrush with its bristles coated in thick black ink. The backs of my hands held the weight of Nana's melon palms as she helped me outline the ancient markings of our ancestors. Together, we traced back to a time when Tonga was nothing but earth. Ta'e, ta'e, ta'e. I heard these words as if my grandmother was speaking in the broken English she reserved for me and my siblings because we didn't speak Tongan. Kaka, kaka, full you of kaka. Nana's puckered brown mouth was curved downwards like an inverted crescent moon. Her afro, a black cloud, waved back and forth. Shaza banged her bony fists on the lids of her wheelie bins and started to drag her bogan trash down to the curb. But she kept her blue-eyed glare on us.
This is Australia, damn it! F off to Fiji!
Spitting back in full Tongan, my Nana raised both of her fists, which were the size of rock melons. I only found out later that Nana was cursing Sharon for being a dull, bludging meth head harlot while she, my grandmother, slaved away at Arnott's biscuit factory just to put corned beef on the table.
You think you poor? Me no poor.
Shaza shoved up a rude finger at us as if the gesture could return us to the tiny islands from which my Nana came. I shivered again. But not me, not me. I was born here. Shaza was so focused on flipping us off that she forgot about her kiddie pool. Her heels wobbled against plastic sides until she stumbled into the water. The wheelie bins fell sideways and spilled open, revealing crushed VB cans, empty Weet-Bix boxes and stubbed ciggies. Nana cackled like a fire was emanating from a deep and righteous place inside her. Sharon flayed her lanky limbs.
Watch it, lady. I'll deck you on that bloody footpath.
Nana kept laughing, her afro vibrating. Shaza stomped back into her house with the Union Jack of her bikini bottom disappearing beneath her coccyx bone. Once more, I shivered behind my grandmother's back. The streets of Mount Druitt slowly closed in around me as if it was a city to be destroyed by God, reverting me to the dirt of my ancestors. I never painted ngatu with my grandmother again. 2. 4 Avery Street was my Nana's first real home, a 50th birthday present from her 7 children, my father, Auntie Meadow, Auntie Jasmine, Auntie Heilala, Auntie Lily, Auntie Daisy and Uncle Talasi. It was my home too, but only on the weekends. My dad would drop off his first three kids and then he'd go back to his second wife, stepson and my two baby half-sisters. Nailed to the front of the heavy wooden door of my nana's house was a red and gold plaque that read, Fe Ofa Aki, which meant, love one another. My home, as home God, we love, Nana explained, tears running down her face as she swallowed the gift her children bestowed upon her. The home of Fe Ofa Aki was a red and cream two-story structure made of cement and wrought iron, flanked by two wide and blossoming palm trees. When I first saw my nana's house, I thought it was a castle right in the middle of Mount Druitt. Nah, some wogs built it in the 60s and then some lebo druggos bought it in the 90s and trashed it. That's why we could afford it, my Auntie Meadow clarified. The night she explained that to me, Auntie Meadow's weight was wrapped tightly in a giant towel. I watched as she patted dry her bare breasts, stomach and thighs, which all fell into each other in fleshy, fair and freckly folds. Got my rags, she lamented. All these cramps, but I can't have kids because I got the shallow end of the gene pool. What a burden. There were streaks of red within her towel's fibres. I shrugged. You got me. For the rest of the night, Aunt Meadow and I caught a rerun of The Lion King on the Foxtel she'd bought 5 years earlier, back when we lived in Housing Commission. The little black subscription box was the most expensive tech we owned, and it served as a reminder that Auntie Meadow was fulfilling her duties of providing for the family as Nana's eldest daughter and my mehekitanga. Of all my aunties, I was Meadow. We were the same. Both the firstborn daughters, both half-Tongan and half-white, and both named Meadow. Auntie Meadow taught me that in English, our name meant a piece of grassland, and in Tongan, we were simply grass. This was the reason we were sometimes called by the nickname Musi. But we rarely referred to each other this way. To me, my auntie was Lahi, meaning senior. To Lahi, I was Si'i, meaning junior. We even shared our name, according to Lahi, with the daughter of a mobster in some show I wasn't allowed to watch. Typical. Eventually, Lahi went on to explain, like an encyclopedia, that for Tongans, the more names a person was given, the more important they were. Among all my names, it took me ages to memorise my actual and full one. Meadow Kakala Teresa Feofa Aki Reed. Every distant relative I ever came across took the time to recite each title like I was part of the royal family. But I only liked my last name because it sounded the same as Reed. Even though I only visited 4 Avery Street on weekends and school holidays, it was our first real home. The house lives in my memory like a permanent resident. Nana exists on the outside, painting ngatu or tending to her garden along the wrought iron fence. One Saturday, I was helping Nana pull weeds. All day we uprooted large clumps of bindies, buckhorn and tiny clusters of clovers. When I wanted a break, I grabbed bundles of roots and ran over to the storm drain just past our house and stuffed the weeds in the gutter. There, I peeked a glimpse over at Sharon's house. I hadn't seen Shazza since the incident with the wheelie bins. The wogs next door, on our side of Avery Street, said she had become a recluse after her son died of a meth overdose. I stared at Shazza's dilapidated bungalow, with the grass of her front lawn grown to knee height, until I noticed her blinds moving. I rushed back to my grandmother. Pa langi vie mea, Nana reminded me through a breathy laugh. The tanned, soft, firm skin of her upper arms shook like clipped bird wings. Nana paused to rip an aloe from its stem and showed me the thick, clear sap oozing from its open wound. She explained in a mixture of Tongan and English, Put open on pala, misho, misho. She brought the aloe vera flesh to an old graze on my knee, which I had gotten from tripping while playing footy with my brother, Jared. I was so unco for a fob, probably from being half palangi. The aloe vera cooled the fresh whitish skin of my scab and left a sticky sheen. The tickly sensation made me giggle. From a thin, still-growing tree, Nana plucked nonu, white-yellow fruit, which reminded me of the grubs in Pumbaa's mouth. I had watched The Lion King 127 times because Mufasa's death reminded me of my mummy, Leo. Mummy died and crossed an unwinding path into heaven months and months ago. With each rerun, I sat with my nose pressed up against the bulky TV screen just as Mufasa fell from the cliffside and into the stampede below. "No," I whispered along with Simba, as I remembered how my mummy was placed in a box and lowered into a dark, dark hole dug out of the mud at Rookwood Cemetery. With her melon palms, Nana crushed the fruit until its juice ran out from her clenched fist.
"Drink from the nonu and no more pala in here."
My grandmother pulled back her full brown lips to reveal bark-coloured gums and gold-plated front teeth. In the back of her mouth were dark, dark gaps. I drew my own lips down and swore to G-O-D that it was the nonu which made Nana's teeth fall out. When my grandmother saw my resistance, she scoffed and bit into the nonu herself. She warned,
"You puke, you get big sick, no come me."
Mixed in with these medicine plants were rose bushes of every colour. Nana's first husband, Liam, who was English-Scottish, had introduced her to roses. Liam left our family when my dad was still a boy. He went back to England and then back to Scotland and then married an Irish Welsh lady. Or so I heard when my aunties Sirius talked. Apparently, Liam became dead to our family when he didn't show up for the birth of his first granddaughter, me. We carried his Palangi last name, Reed, like a tombstone. Lahi, who knew more than any wizard at Hogwarts, once explained to me the meaning of our leftover last name. British and Scottish origin, means someone with red hair. Then she tightened her black low ponytail with a grimace. Despite all that, I knew Liam was the only reason my Nana was able to bring our family to Australia. I pieced all this together from years of overheard serious talk between my aunts, who believed I was too young to understand. Nana was forced to leave Tonga as a teenager because she fell in love with a poor village boy. Poor, as in worth less than the dirt on his feet. Ikai, meaning no, was all my Nana's father, great-grandpa Palisi, needed to say in his Catholic preacher voice to end the relationship. Hours later, great-grandpa Palisi shipped Nana off to New Zealand. There, she stayed with her aunt Hina, who was my great-aunt. Named after an old god, Great Aunt Hina taught my grandmother how to dress in flared pants and loose floral button-downs, a world away from Tonga's plain grey dresses, ta'ovala and sandals. As Nana grew into adulthood, she came to love her aunt so much that she even denounced the Catholicism of her father and converted to her aunt's Wesleyan church. It was at the Wesleyan church, while trimming a bouquet of roses for the minister's podium, that Nana met Grandpa Liam. Tired with his life in England, Liam had travelled to New Zealand by boat and then joined the church for a bit of fun. He was also bored of his own Catholic upbringing. Upon witnessing my Nana's melon fingers gracefully cutting rose stems with a rusted kitchen knife, Liam bent on one knee. Io, meaning yes, was all Great Aunt Hina needed to say in her Wellington College of Education Studies voice to secure the relationship. As Mehe Kitanga, Great Aunt Hina knew too well that her teaching degree could not bring the remainder of our family to New Zealand. Only a white man held such powers. Shortly after their marriage, Liam and my grandmother migrated to Sydney. Their move was made easy, firstly, because of Liam's British citizenship, and secondly, because Grandpa Liam lied and said my grandmother was Māori, who were the only islanders exempt from the White Australia policy. By the time Liam and Nana's first son, my father, was born, the White Australia policy had ended and my grandmother had already listed tens of tens of tens of family members ready to immigrate. Shortly after my auntie Jasmine's birth in the early 1980s, my grandparents were divorced, but by then all of our family had obtained permanent visas. Yet, even with so many more empty mouths, Liam left an empty bank account and a no-return address, swearing he'd given enough charity to our family and our culture to last several lifetimes. Being one of the first Tongan women to marry, bear children with, and then divorce a young white man, my grandmother ensured we were among the first Tongans to live in Australia as Australians. From great-grandpa Palisi, who shipped his own daughter away from her land, from the Palangi, Liam, who left his Tongan bride better yet worse off, to Tupou, the Tongan man Nana married after all this, who did nothing but piss his wife off.
The old god come bird, swoop, swoop, and snip, snip at the worm, for make man. See, remember? All man kai the dirt, disgust, but no this, that paku days, te volo timi.
I knew kai was eating and te volo meant devils, but as if I could know everything my grandmother was saying. Instead, I just rubbed at my temples and watched as she tended to her flowers, spraying extra water on the petals purple in hue. Maybe all Nana's history was predetermined by a higher power. After all, my grandmother's Tongan name was Lose, meaning that her English name was Rose. 3. Only my grandmother's melon hands could open the house of Fe'ofa'aki. Her palms were plump and pleated by the years she worked at Arnott's Biscuit Factory in North Strathfield. Even though we didn't live at Nana's, we spent so many weekends there that I knew the house like it was my own. The front of Fe'ofa'aki unlocked to a small hallway made of wood. On the left was a massive archway that marked the entrance into the living room. On the right was the flimsy door to my Auntie Jasmine's room. Auntie Jasmine was the third eldest child, born after my father and Auntie Meadow. She was the biggest woman in our family. Her full tummy fell down in one lump all the way to her skinny knees.
"Change rooms in Target call me an apple like the forbidden fruit," she once explained while rolling her body around like a swollen snake.
In Tongan, Auntie Jasmine's name was Sesimina, which is why we sometimes called her Big Sessie instead of her full English name. In the days I spent within the house of Fe'ofa'aki, everyone knew each other in both English and Tongan because it was what we were made out of, whiteness and dirt. Hung beside Auntie Jasmine's bedroom door was a framed picture of the Virgin Mary standing in a field of clouds surrounded by light. Virgin Mary's orange-brown hair fell in waves from underneath a white cloth while her pale feet floated forever above a crescent moon. To me, Big Sessie was just a fatter version of the Mother of God. Both women were of the same light, bright skin, and both women wished for an immaculate conception. Across from the portrait of Mother Mary was the living room. Fibers of a lilac rug filled the spaces between my toes as I flexed my feet. Behind a rickety wooden sliding door, Nana was clanking pots. She was usually in the kitchen when she was inside the house of Fe'ofa'aki. Thud, thud, thud went the footsteps of my brother Jared and my sister Nettie on the ceiling above her as they played footy upstairs. In the centre of the living room, the lilac rug stretched under a violet claw-footed couch. On every inch of wall swirled gold frames, all filled with pictures of the Messiah. I curled up in the middle of the velvet-seated couch and inhaled silver specks of dust. Above me weren't just pictures of Jesus, but a statue of Jesus as well. He stood stoically near another open archway, this one covered by a stapled bedsheet, which led into Nana and Tupou's room. I stared back at Jesus' glass blue eyes, long straight blonde hair, and marble white skin. Everything I knew about Jesus, I knew because of Nana. Jesus was a shepherd. Jesus was the Son of God. Jesus was a healer. Jesus died on the cross for our sins.
Jesus rose again as the Holy Spirit. Jesus came from England. Jesus used our bodies to perform miracles. Jesus only let us into heaven if we gave all our money to the church. Jesus loved us with his blood. Tongans loved Jesus. Tongans loved Jesus extra much to make up for the millennia we didn't know Jesus. Tongans gave up tātātau, meaning tattoos, for Jesus. For Jesus, Tongans gave up our hair instead of our fingers when those we loved passed on. Tongans gave up our land for Jesus. We gave up eating each other for Jesus, thank Jesus. Whether a statue or a framed imitation of Leonardo da Vinci's artworks, Jesus looked the same, light-skinned, light-haired, light-eyed. As a child, whenever I looked at the Son of God, I believed that the Palangi were the holiest of us all. Directly opposite the couch were Nana's special display cabinets with golden handles. They were actually three single plywood cupboards stuck side by side in order to create the illusion of one giant glass case. I thought the handles were made of real gold before they started bubbling and peeling in the summer heat and revealed plastic the colour of chicken bones. Tongans were always trying to show off how rich we were, even though we were poor as muck, because we were poor as muck. The small incomes Tongans made working on farms, in warehouses and on countless night shifts went into our churches, our large families, our larger extended families, and our endless cycles of weddings and funerals. The little that remained, if any, was sent overseas to our distant, distant, distant relatives, which was basically any Tongan living in Tonga. Even though I grew up on canned bolognese and tinned beef, my Nana always spared enough money for her display cabinets. She filled the shelves with porcelain teapots and teacups, commemorative plates with the face of a princess named Diana printed on them, golden trophies from all the football games her son and stepson won, and first place blue ribbons from all the school singing competitions her daughters and stepdaughter won. Scattered throughout each treasure were faded photographs of when my Nana was not Nana, but a young girl in grey dresses with a fronds shadow over her freckly face. Prominently placed at the front of the glass panels were glossy school pictures of me, Jared, and Nettie. My siblings and I shared the same brown-black eyes, black bushy brows, and dark green Wayland public school uniforms. The only difference between us was our skin tones. Jared and me were brown like the top of the ngatus our Nana painted all day. Nettie was as sun-bleached as the underside of the ngatu. While Dad left this half of his family with Nana, he was getting busy cementing the second half of his family. Also on the glass panels was a picture of the woman Dad remarried, Camelia, her sprouty spud son, Corey, and two newborns, my littlest sisters, Lani and Love. In the background of the photo was our family church, Tokaikolo. But we didn't talk about that side of my family in the house of Feofa'aki. Instead, everyone just said how Nettie was prettier than me. So fair, so fair, Auntie Jasmine crooned once as my younger sister slept on her lumpy lap. So like Mami Leo, eh? A wave of heat washed over my cheeks as I yelled out that Nettie might as well be adopted since she was so pale. That was one of the few times Lahi told me off, explaining that it was a sin to make my sister cry because she looked so much like our dead mum. Our dead mum, Mami Leo, was also half white and half Tongan, just like our living dad. I used to get confused when I tried to tell the kids at school that both my parents were mixed race. Sometimes I said I was full white and full Tongan. Being bad at maths, I thought that anything with two halves made two separate yet full wholes. Only as an adult did I realize the reason for my ignorance. Despite the Anglo-genetics that contributed to my slim waist, narrow nose, and light brown skin, I grew up with absolutely no white relatives. Everybody who raised me was Tongan. Everybody who loved me was Tongan. And that made me fully Tongan. Mummy Leo died of cancer when I was 4, when Nettie was 2, and when Jared was just 6 months old. Neither of my siblings remembered our mum's funeral, but I went back there whenever Mufasa fell to his death, when all I saw was my mother in her coffin with her marble-white skin all covered in dark blue veins.
Whenever we visited Mummy Le'o at Rookwood Cemetery, I read the Bible verse on her tombstone over and over again. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Without the semicolon between those two phrases, as it actually appears in the Bible, I interpreted the verse to mean I couldn't want God, so I could never want my mum. Translation, suck it up, buttercup. Back in the house of Fe'ofa'aki, past Auntie Jasmine's room, was the base of the carpeted stairs. To the left of the stairs was a blue-tiled bathroom. It was the only bathroom in the whole house, so it was shared by all of my aunties and us three kids when we were visiting on weekends and school holidays. No matter how many times I saw my nana scrubbing away in the tiny bathroom with an old sponge, elbow deep in the toilet bowl, the dunny was forever cacked with a fresh caca stain. From the tiny blue tiles all the way to the ceiling were clusters of stubborn black mould. Flecks of toothpaste freckled the vanity cabinet and made it hard for us to see our reflections. Before Christian missionaries, Tongans lived in open whales, pooed in tropical foliage, and only showered when it rained. 200 years later, Tongans were still getting used to the idea of walls, flushing porcelain and unseen plumbing, let alone having to clean it all. From morning until evening, until morning again, my aunties fought over the bathroom. Lahi took too long toweling her fallen over folds. Auntie Heilala took too long picking at her face. Auntie Jasmine took too long mopping up her monthly reminder that she wasn't pregnant. Auntie Lily took too long dyeing her black strands to blonde red streaks. Auntie Daisy took too long slicing herself up with a razor blade. Auntie Lily and Auntie Daisy were the youngest and darkest of all my aunties. This was because Nana swore to never let a Palangi man touch her again. So, when she felt it was time to remarry in the late 1980s, my grandmother went back to Tonga. The man she found was named Tupou, and he was from the village of Afa, which was known to produce offspring immune to shark attacks. Tupou's skin resembled the uli of the most sacred and blackest inked ngatu. That was why my nana chose Tupou, because he was dark as earth and imbued with predator repellent. My siblings and I called him Tata for short, a nickname Jared made up because Tupou's round and hard belly made a tata sound whenever my brother jumped on the only grandfather we really knew. A few steps from the bathroom, just bypassing the carpeted stairs, was Auntie Daisy's bedroom. Auntie Daisy was the thinnest of my aunts, meaning that she was simply overweight rather than morbidly obese. Daisy was only 7 years older than me and felt more like my big sister than an auntie. Her Tongan name was Saini, which translated to the English word chain. That was why my auntie told us that even in the house of Fe'ofa'aki, we were to say her white name only. Once, in the space between the bathroom and her bedroom, Daisy explained it like this. Selfdk is my name the same as something used on slaves. Do I look like a slave to you? I furrowed my brows at her dark brown skin, wide flared nostrils and tightly knotted black curls and replied without even thinking, you do. To our neighbour Shazza, you do. My sister aunt scrunched her flat brown nose and pulled my ponytail, mocking me. The nits in my hair were sucking my blood and having S-E-X on my head. Yeah, well, if your mummy Le'o was alive, she'd cut you for being all rude and festy. I clawed at Daisy's scratched up forearm until she slammed her bedroom door into my face, forcing me out. Superglued on the front of the door was a white plastic plaque that read in bold red letters, Beware of the dog. Next to the warning were harsh black outlines of a snarling pit bull. I was never really sure why Daisy put the plaque there. Around the house of Fe'ofa'aki, there was nothing but stray white-furred cats all named Angel. They were to keep mice from chewing up Nana's ngatus, which were made from strips of mulberry bark glued together with flour and water. At the end of Auntie Daisy's bedroom was a dark, dark cupboard under the dark, dark stairs where all her dark, dark clothes were piled up. Once, I heard Lahi and Big Sassy serious talking that Auntie Daisy cried in her bedroom at night and burnt all her colourful clothes. The cupboard under the stairs reminded me of a scary story my father once whispered about a dark, dark house in a dark, dark forest where a dark, dark ghost was trapped alone forever. Me and my brother Jared once dared our sister Nettie to hide in the cupboard. We giggled as Nettie pouted her pink lips and shuffled slowly into the blackness as she tried to prove her bravery, white skin glowing like a halo. Jared and I blocked the door with our bodies and yelled, "Dark, dark girl!" Nettie screamed her lungs out and banged her baby born against the wooden door. Jared and I got a real ear flick from Nana that day because we dared to bring a tevolo into her home, a devil so bad it made Nettie bite her forearms until she bled. I couldn't explain to Nana that Nettie was seriously dur in the head and not possessed, but I did agree that there was a dark spirit in the house of Felfaaki. Why else did Auntie Daisy sob in the middle of the night and slice up her skin? Up the carpeted stairs was a second and smaller living room. This was where my brother Jared was now pretending to land footy tries by using a mattress on the floor as his field. Jared had twiggy thighs, airy arms and sharp shoulders, all topped with fizzy thick hair the colour of an overcooked McNugget. My brother was a short and scrawny kid, smaller than the average fob boy. But out of all five of my siblings, he looked the most Tongan, with his browner skin, wider nose and well-rounded fingertips. Jared also loved footy like a real fob. He was always telling us how one day he was going to be on TV like Sonny Bill Williams. "Sonny Bill's hangs with Muslims," I once said with stiff shoulders and a giant grin. Jared just mumble laughed at me. "There's only Jesus, bro." That pretend footy field of a mattress was also where Lahi slept on weekends. Jared and I were both too selfish to properly share our mum-like aunt, so Lahi was forced to sleep on the living room floor. This way, she could separate my brother and me with her wall of flesh. The separation between brother and sister was important because it upheld the Tongan values of fa'aka'apa and tauhi vaha'a between us. One night, on the floor mattress, Lahi explained it like this. "Our culture is based on the relationship between brother and sister. Jared, you are the tuonga ane, the keeper of your sister's honour, which is our family's honour. Si'i, you will be mehekitanga, the leader of your brother and his children. Teach them how to carry our family into the future. This is why you must never lie down together. This is why you must cover up around each other. This is why you must never be alone together. Vei tapui, your bond is sacred." Thud, thud, thud. Crowning the smaller upstairs living room was a street-facing balcony. Those double doors stayed open in summer to bring in the cool breeze that the palm trees caught. In the winter, they stayed closed and acted like a giant mirror. Next to the balcony doors was a frayed couch where my sister Nettie now sat, pressing the pale baby born to her chest as if it came out of her. My aunties called Nettie a backwards coconut, white on the outside, but brown on the inside because only a real fob girl could like babies as much as she did. Jared and I sometimes wondered if Nettie was all there in the head. She didn't walk until she was two, she was a mute until 5 years old, and at nine, she still sucked her thumb, sometimes until she bled. And all Nettie ever did was play with that baby born. "Gonna born 10 babies, she once predicted through her thumb. From teenage pregnancies to nightclub knockups, I came to understand that Tongans like my sister had subconsciously taken it upon themselves to be fruitful and multiply. Nature gave them no choice. In all of the three island groups of Tonga, there were only 100,000 of us. On one side of the living room, nearest the top of the stairs, were more doors. The first door on the left was my Auntie Heilala's room, which is just a large and overstuffed bed that stretched from the wardrobe to the wall. Even I needed to shuffle in sideways just to get inside, and I was the skinniest person in the house of Felfaaki. Only God knew how Auntie Heilala was able to squeeze her flabby folds into her sheets each night. Auntie Heilala was Tata's only daughter from his first marriage. Even though all my aunties were Tongan, Auntie Heilala was the only one of them to be born in Tonga. I figured that's why she was named after Tonga's national flower. Auntie Heilala was shaped like a kettle pot, and her puffy cheeks were covered in small brown holes because she constantly picked at her acne. Even though my aunties came from different sets of parents, they all looked the same, big like only islanders can be. Once, As Lahi shuffled into a pair of extra, 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 extra large boy boxes, my mehekitanga explained it like this. No worries for the rest of our fat days. There's a reason why Kamaka Viavole can sing somewhere over the rainbow like an ocean breeze. All that weight pushes our lungs together and makes our breath cute and fluffy. No one in the world can sing like us islanders. We be big best. It made sense when Lahi explained it like that, because her squishy stomach was the best pillow to rest my head against. The aunt I was named after could also hit high notes during Sunday morning prayers that only trained opera singers could reach. Auntie Meadow and all my other aunties carried their weight like a gift, too. Unlike the bogan slobs I saw shuffling around Mount Druitt Westfield with their hairy beer bellies hanging out of two tight singlets. Right next to Auntie Heilala's room was Auntie Lily's room, which had shag carpet for walls and a tiled mirror at the head of her four-poster bed. Lily's bedroom was so outdated that it felt like stepping back in time. Auntie Lily was the first child born between Nana and Tata. Her existence was what allowed Tata to leave his first wife. Nana explained that Lily was all part God planning, eh? But Auntie Lily disagreed when she told me, Tongans want to act holy, Cheech, but we just horny. Auntie Lily's other name was Swa, and I still don't know the English equivalent, probably because it wasn't a fob name at all. There's no W in the Tongan alphabet. I reckon Swa just made it up to stand out amongst her many sisters. Anyhow, Swa's chosen name was neither Tongan nor English, which meant my aunt could be whoever she wanted to be. On Swa's streak-stained tiled mirror were blue-tacked printouts of Andrew Fifita from the Sharks. Even though she wasn't married, Swa swore to G.O.D. that Fifita was her husband because he had also grown up in Blacktown and Mount Druitt. None of my aunties were married. I reckon they never wanted to admit how being big, brown women made it impossible for them to find husbands. Aussies were disgusted by them. Australian-born islanders only wanted Aussies. Arabs, Asians, and Africans were way too foreign to even consider. I did hear that in a somewhere place like Queensland, a fair few Aboriginal people married islanders, but there was no way my aunties were leaving Mountie County for Aussie Texas. At least that's what Swa called it. The only choice my aunts had were to marry freshies, Tongans who could love them just as much as they loved an Australian citizenship. To get to Lahi's room, I passed the frayed couch and brushed past our bulky black computer. The IBM sat on a particle board desk topped with wires and steel boxes of wicker wicker stuff. Everything was covered in sticky syrup patches full of twitching semi-dead ants. The ants were attracted to the Macca's cup half-filled with Fanta that everyone left lying around the home of Feofa'aki. The front of Lahi's bedroom door was marked with a wonky heart shape that I had tagged using her Rexona Ocean Breeze deodorant can. I needed Lahi to know she was loved, even when me and my brother Jared and my sister Nettie were at our other home with Dad, because we lived with our father, stepmother, stepbrother and littlest sisters in Plumpton more than we ever lived at the castle in Mount Druitt. I reckoned Lahi knew all this because she never wiped my tag clean. Inside Lahi's room was a four-poster bed like her sister Swa's, but Lahi's four wooden posts were overlaid with sheer fabric, which made the bed look as if it came from a Disney princess movie. On the left side of Lahi's bedroom was a wall-to-wall window overlooking Avery Street. Adjacent to the window was an ornate mirror with a marble bench top. Lahi's vanity was covered in glass bottles of men's perfume, half-open packets of pads and an assortment of unpaid bills. To the side of the mirror was a flimsy wooden door that led into a walk-in closet. Even though Lahi was a girl, my mother aunt's wardrobe was filled with suits and ties she wore for her job at Moultrie Money Management. I suspected that Lahi's style was related to a video I once saw on the ant-coated computer just outside her bedroom. Late one night, inside a pixelated...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.